Welcome to summer in April. It's later than we think. It's heating up now, and it will not stop as far as the world is concerned. You listen to the pundits on all sides talking, and it's just boiling. They're just boiling. So we cannot afford to fail to reach peace of mind at this time. It's all important. Now, I planted a garden this year, March 16th, it was in. Very early, crazy early. But I took a risk. I said, you know what, I got a feeling it's going to be very warm from now on. And it has been. It's been unbelievable. So sometimes we have to take a risk and do something ahead of time. Early in the game. I showed a picture I took of some tomatoes that are already setting, nice size, they're growing, and I showed it to an expert gardener, and he said, no way, it's impossible, you're joking, that's from last year, it's impossible, it cannot be this early, no way. So you see, I believe in the world there are those who believe in freedom and deliverance, and yet they don't think it's possible yet. They don't think it's possible yet. And they're experts, so-called experts. And they say, well, yeah, it's coming, but not yet. Not, can't do it yet. Okay, we have to do it in their eyes early. Well, they may even be disbelieve it. They disbelieve it. They say, no, no. The problem is, though, with those, it's always not yet. It's always not yet. The potential is always there, but it's always not yet. However, there's some who are very bold, and they say, we're going to do it now, we're going to do it early, we're going to do it in the right timing, we're going to do it ahead of the times when the persecution complex crystallizes in this world. You see, there are troubles coming in the world, most certainly. And there are what's called a persecution complex. It has been building up in the world to an extraordinary extent, which results in scapegoating others that they feel are persecuting them, who are preventing them from building a perfect utopia here, from improving conditions for people. Now, there are those who are wise saying, wait a minute, let's not go too far in that direction. Let's just kind of keep a balance. Let's keep a middle path. Let's be humble in our attitudes. Okay? We're not asking ourselves to be dirt poor or anything like that. We're just asking ourselves to be humble enough in our attitudes that the majority of time we spend is in contemplation and consideration of truth and clarity, so that we don't spend so much time trying to build up surpluses and progress and measurement and calibration so everything is more and more sophisticated. Let's not be so obsessed with that. Simple life. Glass of lemonade, for instance. Just sit here. Simple glass of lemonade. Something that people have been drinking for probably thousands of years, lemonade. They got some lemons, they had some honey, you make lemonade, you sit down. People have been sitting down forever, right? So you sit down and you listen. Okay, glass of lemonade, sit down, listen. How difficult is that? Do we need all this sophistication in the world to do that? Answer is no, of course not. Does all the sophistication in the world that we see everywhere, does that really tip the balance in some way? Can we not, without all that sophistication, let's say it's all gone, can we not sit down, have a glass of lemonade, and listen, pay attention and consider things? Do we not still have a mind? Do we not still have reason? Do we still not have the capacity to clarify? People, we've been doing it for thousands and thousands of years. So what we find in today's world is that people are saying, well, we're going to do it. Not yet, though. We have all this sophistication. First, we need to build up the sophistication. And then, you know what? My entire life, I've been hearing that same excuse that, oh, we're going to do it. But just not quite yet, because we have these discoveries and inventions we need to make. And that's continually goes on and on and on and on and on and on, and they never get around to it. That's lacking a sense of humility and simplicity and determination, saying, you know, I can do it. I don't have to wait for do you need to wait for a calculator to be invented to add 2 plus 2? Is that really necessary? Have we not been able to add 2 plus 2 for a long time? So do we need to wait for an invention of microchips and calculators so we can calculate what's 2 plus 2? No, we don't. The truth is simple. The truth requires a keen mind, a mind that is very keen, very determined, and very confident, and has the ability to quietly observe and pay attention and notice and put 2 plus 2 together, basically. All right, so we can do that. We've always been able to do that. The only thing we're lacking is the doing of it. That's it. And that's what's lacking in the world right now. The only thing that's lacking in the world is doing what needs to be done. That's it. And yet the world is increasingly saying, now wait a minute. Before we do what needs to be done, let's gawk at this incredible sophistication we've been able to make, and let's kind of see what we can do with that first, and then we'll do what needs to be done tomorrow, mañana. And that's the sickness of the world. The world is profoundly sick right now with that, with this dynamic. And the world is too caught up in the wow factor of technology, the wow factor of social media, the wow factor of connectivity, the wow factor of the global community, the wow factor of instant news and et cetera, et cetera. The wow factor has everybody thinking like, well, wait a minute, I don't want to miss anything. What's next? What's next? Instead of saying, hey, let's get back to the nitty-gritty here and let's do the real work. So you have a world that we will always say, yeah, we're going to get to it soon. We're going to get to it. But certainly you don't. It's too soon to get to it. You're not trying to get to it now, are you? I mean, it's too soon. You're planting your garden too soon. It's sure to be stunted. Sure, something, you know, it's not going to work out good for you. Well, my plants are absolutely going nuts. They're just monsters. You know, the tomato plants, and it's April, what is it, 23rd or something? April 23rd. And it's setting tomatoes, and it's just like, you know, now's the time. Now is the time. And that is the message. Now is the time to discover truth. Now is the time to actually step into bliss, to accept peace of mind. Now is the time. Later will be too difficult. When this persecution complex that has been building up in the world, a feeling that those who are trying to create the great society, the utopia in the world, are being obstructed and persecuted for their efforts, their righteous efforts, when that crystallizes, then you have what's called scapegoating. And even though there isn't a persecution, even though there are those, many in the world who say, hey, let's not go all in for this great society. Let's not go overboard. Let's continue to, no matter what, continue to contemplate and clarify the truth as our primary objective. Those people will be scapegoated as if they're obstructing the great society. But they don't have to be scapegoated. If they have peace of mind, if they have bliss, they'll also have the capacity to sidestep the scapegoating and say, no, that's inappropriate to scapegoat us. We're not persecuting anybody. We're just sticking with what we know works and what has to be done. So what has to be done is simply accepting the condition that we're in, without fighting against it, without struggling too much, and realizing that this is a necessary defense against mental chaos, the situation we're in. It's a necessary defense. And you can actually take this to the point where you are thanking with gratitude the ego, which is the sum total of all devices we're using to defend against mental chaos, thanking that for doing such a fabulous job, such a perfect, fabulous job, a necessary job. So there's nothing that's going on that isn't necessary. We can see that, actually see it. And instead of having a negative attitude towards the ego, saying we've got to kill the ego, kill the mind, all that, just the opposite. Say, mind, you've done a perfect job with the idea that we gave you. You absolutely had to defend against mental chaos. And all these tricks and self-deception you used were necessary. So thank you very much. You did a very wonderful job. Very grateful for that. So in other words, what is that? No resistance. No more resistance. Drop resistance to the ego and say, thank you, ego. No judgment, no resistance, just a gratitude of not even forgiveness. No, gratitude. Because it's either these defenses or mental chaos. That is a fact. Because as long as spirit doesn't change the idea of wanting to be prime creator, the fear of annihilation symbolized in the mind by mental chaos will be there. So it's either try to experience mental chaos or defend against it. So defending against it is the right move. It's, in fact, it's a necessary move because it's impossible to abide in mental chaos. So it's a necessary move. So mind has done exactly what needed to be done. It needs to be done. All this trickeration and confusion and everything, this fumbling and bumbling around, identifying with bodies, everything has been necessary. It's necessary. So there's nothing to forgive. There's only, see it and say, thank you so much for protecting me from mental chaos. Terrific job. So this is a step, and we have gratitude and thanks, and not even, no forgiveness necessary. Say, thank you. Perfect job. Wonderful. I'm so grateful. No resistance to anything in the world. No resistance. No resistance to anything that's ever happened. It was all helpful, very beneficial, actually, in relation to the other option. It was terrible. So yeah, of course we've suffered, et cetera, et cetera. But the option to that is way, way worse. So what it was we were in a situation of lesser of two evils, and offending against a terrible, terrible experience. So no more hatred for the ego. In fact, the ego is now the hero. Thank you, ego, for doing such a great job. Thank you, mind, for doing such a great job in keeping my attention wrapped up in such a way that I would not experience mental chaos. So with that non-resistance there, feeling of non-resistance and no more fighting, struggling against what is, what arises. Everything that arises is welcome. Then there's one more step that can be taken. And this step is called the relinquishment of existence. It's saying, I relinquish all future karma, all potentiality that could possibly come to me in existence. I relinquish it. I relinquish all rights or claims to it whatsoever. Furthermore, I relinquish all rights to disperse my karma to who I want to disperse it to. That's also, I'm playing no role in that. Disperse it to whoever you want. Let's say your karma was that you're going to become have a lifetime where you become a billionaire, okay, and have all the yachts and live an incredible, lavish lifestyle, etc. You relinquish that. You say, I relinquish that right now, this moment. I relinquish all future potentialities in existence. Plus, you relinquish this, all the billions of dollars that we're going to be coming to in a future life. You relinquish how that billions of dollars would be dispersed. I mean, who's going to get it? Who's going to get the lavish lifestyle? You see, you relinquish any say in that whatsoever. So you're no longer a player. You're no longer a player in existence at all. This is called detachment. This is called true detachment. And in running this, testing it today, I found this sense, amazing sense, a different feeling. This is a very different reaction than what you would expect. It's like a relief, tremendous relief. Relinquishing all, Now, Jesus said, he who would lose his life will gain his life, will gain eternal life, which is exactly what he's talking about here. He who would relinquish all future potentiality in existence, all lives, all wives, all husbands, all children, all jobs, all careers, all success, all failure, everything, the whole soup, everything that could possibly happen in existence, relinquish it and say, I no longer have any claim whatsoever upon any of that. Nor do I have any claim of how anything that may be coming to me through my karma is dispersed. Makes no difference. Wherever it goes to makes no difference. It doesn't matter. But you can do that because you know that this whole thing is necessary defense against mental chaos, that whatever happens is fine because it's a defense. It's a necessary defense. So whoever gets the money, whoever gets the job, whoever gets whatever, that's all okay. It's all good. It's all equally good. It's all fine. It's no problem. Because those who maintain the idea of wanting to be prime creator need the defenses. But those who are decided to change ideas, exchange hypotheticals to what if reality can't be changed, they don't need any potentiality from existence whatsoever. They don't need any defenses against mental chaos. They don't need any more. So mind, once you see that mind is doing a perfect job, you trust it, and you say, mind, I'm turning over all my future karma to you, because I know you'll do what needs to be done. Those who keep this idea will continue to have to be, you know, suffering and confused and imbecilic and self-deceived and all this stuff. They'll need to. So it's okay. Whoever becomes the billionaire, that's okay. whoever becomes an egomaniac, that's okay. Whatever happens is okay. Mind is just using everything to defend against mental chaos, to keep us from trying to solidify and crystallize this idea. In other words, we're trying to limit loss. Mind is painting a picture of limiting loss. Without that picture of limiting loss, we would experience total mental chaos. So mind's doing a fabulous job with death, with impermanence, all this nature of giving us a movie of limited loss. So we're all engrossed in this movie of limited loss. Okay, and that diverts our attention away from this dread of annihilation, which is symbolized in the mind by mental chaos. We say, oh, you know, the mental chaos is something in the past, and this is, it's been transformed into this limited loss sort of thing. So mind is doing a very benevolent thing, actually, totally benevolent. If we see the context of the benevolence. So we can exchange hypotheticals, and there's no fear of annihilation arising in the idea of accepting reality as it is, that it can't be changed. No need to defend against it. No need to have this movie of limited loss. We step into bliss. We step into peace of mind. We step into a condition of complete detachment and indifference to whatever happens in the world. And a trust in the mind. We trust the mind to use whatever dynamics were involved with our karma in the future. Mind will disperse those in whatever way is most benevolent. So we don't have to worry about that. We trust the mind. We regain trust in the mind. Mind has not been acting crazy at all, actually. It's been acting with incredible wisdom, beautiful presentation of limiting loss, and making us think that our identity here is, we're here and we're experiencing limiting loss being limited, bit by bit by bit by bit kind of thing, instead of all at once, total mental chaos, which is what we don't want. Now, step 2B would be, to give up, also you give up all enlightenment. Now this is a real profound one. Maybe the most profound step of all, the final step, is the potentiality in existence, in this dream. Mind claims there's this potential for enlightenment. Why? To keep us watching the movie. Okay, again, the movie is necessary to watch. Limiting loss is necessary. The option being not limiting loss and experiencing total mental chaos. So we need to be watching this movie. And how does spirit keep us watching? How does mind keep us watching this movie? By telling us that there's some end of the rainbow, it's enlightenment. If we keep watching the movie, we'll reach enlightenment. So what we need to do also is to say, I give up any and all claim to any enlightenment within existence. Any and all potentiality, including enlightenment, realization, self-realization, everything, all of that. Because all of that is just the mind tricking us into watching the movie. That's a fact. Because what we really want is this bliss, is this peace of mind, which is beyond any mental, any state of enlightenment within existence, actually. All this stuff about goals within existence is all there to keep us watching the movie. All right, so we can reach all various kinds of states of mind, etc. And but that still keeps us watching the movie. The true state of mind is the true state of detachment. True state of detachment. Total forgiveness, gratitude, relinquishment, renunciation, detachment, acceptance, and then that results in this transcendent type of bliss. An infusion of bliss, actually. And you don't, rarely do you see that in the world. Mostly what you see is various conditions to help people keep watching the movie, because mind is helping everyone out to watch the movie. But when you see through this entire thing and thank the mind, you get a different reaction from the mind. I remember someone telling me this, that when you really detach from the world and have no more use for it, then the world bows down to you. I think it may have been Muji saying that. The world will bow down to you and do anything at your service. It establishes, again, it comes from gratitude to accepting the mind that what it's done is correct, and therefore you trust the mind to also do what's correct with this new hypothetical that you're choosing. You see, as long as we think that the mind is completely crazy and screwing everything up, we will not trust the mind to choose a new idea. We won't give it a new idea. We'll say, no, first we have to heal the mind, and then we'll choose a new idea. But imagine how difficult the task of trying to heal the mind could possibly be. Just impossibly difficult. How could we heal the mind? The fact is, once we see that the mind isn't sick, it's not crazy, it's functioning flawlessly, then we have no fear in saying, hey, let's give it a new idea, let's give it a new hypothetical to present to us, and we trust in the bliss that will come then. So these are the various steps that we can take. This is the nitty-gritty at this time, which is a very different ball game than what we're accustomed to hearing, actually. Although we may have heard it bits and pieces here and there, and it may sound somewhat familiar. This is the nitty-gritty. This is what actually works, is this true renunciation. Renounce the entire, everything that the universe could ever possibly give you. Renounce it right now. And in doing that renunciation right now, you're showing total faith in the mind. Total faith in the mind, which means you're not blaming the mind for anything that's happened in this detour into fear. You're not blaming the mind for anything. It's been functioning brilliantly, amazingly, giving this incredible movie of impermanence for us to spend so much time in, distracting us for so long, until we finally see the ultimate truth behind it all. And until we see what's really going on, It's necessary to be distracted by this movie of impermanence. It's necessary, absolutely necessary. So we're really on track here. Just in the nick of time, of course. And I've been contemplating this today, and everything's normal. Also being distracted by various things, allowing myself to be distracted, not trying to go overboard, not trying to get all frantic about it, just saying, okay, this sounds like this is the right way to go about it. Now there's a basketball game, playoff basketball game right now, Golden State Warriors against Denver, what is it, Nuggets. Second half, very close game, and I'm not watching it. Why? Because this is more important. So it's just a simple choice like this. Just a simple choice, say, prioritize time, and the bottom line is, when it comes down to it, you choose what is more important. This is more important than watching a playoff basketball game, of course. So that's just the difference at this time now. How do you spend time? How do you spend your time? When it gets right down to it, when it's coming down, you know, time is running out, how do you spend that the last bit of time that you have? Do you have one for the road, or you decide, no, that's enough. I've had enough. Let's leave early. Let's leave early, that kind of thing. So let's get the bliss early here. And in hindsight, we'll see it wasn't early at all. It was actually perfect timing. Perfect timing, because the world is more heated up than we know right now. It's really the temperature. If you took the temperature of the world, it would have a very bad fever. And the fever is higher than we expect. A lot of us expect, well, yeah, the fever is coming. But no, it's already here. It's already here. So it is necessary to crack that cosmic egg and get the bliss. Get the bliss. I would be surprised if I don't get the bliss. I would be surprised at this point. I expect it. I absolutely expect it. How can you not get it when you are willing to relinquish the entire universe for good, and you're willing to bless the mind with nothing but gratitude, deep gratitude and friendship? Say, mind, you've been the best of friends all along, absolutely, and mean it. You know, how can that not lead to bliss? It must. It's like when you get the golf swing down just right, and you tee it high and you let it fly. How can you not hit it far? You know you're gonna hit it far. I recently made an adjustment to my golf swing with the driver. Tried something that I had tried before, but not quite properly. And this time I did it right, and the ball is just flying so far, it's unbelievable. I can't even see it. It's just gone. And I go down there, and it's way, 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 way down there. And I just say, wow. You know, if you do it right, it's going to fly. So tee it high and watch it fly. And if you make it the right adjustment, it'll go. So in this clarification here, making the adjustment of seeing the mind not as our enemy, the ego not as our enemy, but as our dearest friends. And then also recognizing that all of existence, all it is this defense against a fear of mental chaos. It's nothing, never going to be anything other than that. And that's, you know, watching a movie of impermanence endlessly is not what we really want. Not what we really want. So we say, hey, let's choose a different idea. Let's exchange hypotheticals instead of the hypothetical of what if reality could be changed. We say, well, what if reality couldn't be changed? And for that, there's no fear of annihilation at all. None. No need to defend against it. No need for mind to present a movie of impermanence. No need whatsoever. So what does it do? It presents a movie of bliss, overlaying everything that you used to watch, the movie that you used to watch, which, because you're staying in the world, other people are still watching the movie. So to function here, you see that this movie's still playing, that everyone's watching, and you can comment on it, you know. But it's overlaid with bliss for you, and the bliss is permanent. There's no impermanence in the overlay. Or if you want to use a reverse metaphor, like you're down in the ocean, the depths of the ocean, and all the waves and chop are playing on the surface, and you can see that, you can notice it, but you're established in the stillness of the depths. See, it doesn't change. The chop on the surface doesn't change. It doesn't cause the ocean to move in the depths at all. And it's not going to make the ocean disappear. The fact that some chop disappears doesn't make the ocean disappear. So that the movie of impermanence doesn't make reality disappear. So that this is the intermediate step, seeing the great overlay of unconditional love and bliss upon this movie of impermanence. That's the intermediate step, and that's all that we need to look at right now. Because beyond that is to set down all hypotheticals and experience reality directly. And that's beyond the scope of even our wildest imagination. And so we don't need to speculate on what that's like. That will be a seamless transition at some point once we are perfectly conformed and familiar with the bliss, the overlay of bliss. So steps have to be taken now to enter into the bliss, absolutely. Otherwise, we're going to get contaminated with the fever. Fever is contagious, you know that. It's not bird flu, it's human flu. It's psychic influenza that we're dealing with right now. And the world has a fever. And people are getting all polarized and all into persecution complexes, which is a very, very dangerous thing now. We're going into hell as far as the world goes, because the persecution complex has been built up to a dangerous level right at this point. And they can easily crystallize into a feeling as if someone else is trying to throw you into mental chaos by preventing you from defending against it the way you feel you need to defend against it. And so that brings a panic and a lashing out, an absolute lashing out. Happens over and over and over in history. This occurs when we try to improve the world too much. We spend too much effort in trying to improve the world, improve our living conditions, all this. This is the backlash that comes. Backlash that comes because that weakens our defenses. Remember, we're supposed to be watching a movie of impermanence to protect us, to defend against mental chaos. So if we start making that movie of impermanence look too nice, you know, then it starts losing its effectiveness. And when that happens, when people start to think, hey, wait a minute, they don't realize what's happening, and they think somebody's preventing me from improving the movie even more. They're getting in the way, and all we need to do is improve it, make it perfect, and make our living conditions perfect, and so everything's perfect for us, and then everything will be fine. And they don't realize that it's the fear of impermanence is percolating up through them, through their weakened defenses, because the movie of impermanence they're watching has been they're toying with it too much. And they're projecting that dread out onto others. It's called scapegoating. They project that out onto others, and others are scapegoated. And then they are attacked, thinking that they're the ones who are bringing this fear. They're trying to annihilate the other people, when in fact it's the fear of mental chaos that is arising within these people who have monkeyed with this movie too much by trying to improve living conditions to too great of an extent. That is certainly what's happened in the world right now. I always said that we should have stopped things at the age of steam, not gone any further. We had the train, we had train tracks. Stop it right there. Don't go any further. All right. The Amish people decided, hey, it's time to stop. This is enough. This is enough, right? Very wise, actually. And there have been people throughout history who have tried to say, hey, wait a minute, this is enough. Let's not push it any further, because we know there's going to be a backlash. But too many in the world who headstrong, stubborn, arrogant attitudes, very prideful attitudes, they know, wait a minute, we can improve this dream. We can improve this movie. let's improve it. And so they've gone to, you know, extreme efforts to improve the movie, where now we have everything on demand. Really, we can shop, get anything on demand, any music, any movie, any type of entertainment, you know, any commodity, you name it. You can have it shipped right to your door. You can watch it like this. That is true. I mean, if you can order a car from Europe, they'll ship it over to your door. Anything at all, you can. If you have the money, you can literally have it delivered to your door. If you want the most beautiful flower lays in the world, just go online, order them from Hawaii or Thailand or wherever, and they will be, you know, FedEx them to your door. They'll be there tomorrow. That is true, isn't it? Any perfume you want from all over the world, you can get like that. Any food, as a matter of fact, you can have food express shipped to your door from anywhere in the world. You can have a chef prepare a meal or something, and our components for it, have it, ingredients, whatever, anything you want, you can have it right now, you see. So we've gone too far. We've gone way, way, way too far. And we have, you know, around the year, the whole year, you can go into the market, at least where I live, and buy any fruit, basically. They ship it from all over the world. You always have blueberries and strawberries and papayas and mangoes and bananas and everything you want is coming from somewhere, South America, you know, Australia, whatever. You have hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of varieties of wine, and you can order any wine you want and have it shipped to your door. See, so we have gone to an unbelievable extent. You can, any song you want to listen to, you can dial it in and listen to it right now, right? Just do a search for it, pay the small amount of money, and download it, and you've got it, and you can be listening to it, and you can put together any playlist you want. In movies, same thing. Watch it on big screens, you know. So we have taken it to another level as far as that's concerned. We've monkeyed with the movie. And in doing so, we have weakened the effect of this distraction to the point where we're getting too jittery. And we try to hide this jitters through all sorts of frivolous activity and distractions and singing and dancing contests and eating contests, and we take all sorts of pharmaceuticals to try to cut down the anxiety and the depression and all this seepage of mental chaos that's seeping up like through the sewers, and we smell it. You know, it's like when we're smelling the sewage. You say, wow, that's terrible, and what do people do? They say, well, let's fire up another joint, you know. That'll get rid of it. Everyone says, yeah, that's it. Like, turn on the music, you know, let's dance, you know, let's party. Let's just go all in and party. Or let's just go to work and produce even more surplus. And meanwhile, the smell's getting stronger and stronger and stronger. And then some people are saying, hey, wait a minute. Somebody is purposefully sabotaging our happiness by... They must be forcing the sewage into our homes, and let's get the bad guys. You know, we got to get the bad guys. How dare they ruin our happiness that way? You know, not realizing where it's coming from. Comes from a weakening of the defenses. It's as long as we choose the idea of wanting to be prime creator, the fear of annihilation will rise. Mind has to symbolize it as total mental chaos that has to be defended against, which is watching a movie of impermanence. That has to be there out of necessity. So if we monkey, so that's why the spiritual teachers will say, hey, just look, just watch the movie of impermanence. Okay, don't try to make it anything special. Don't try to improve upon it too much. You know, don't try to get rid of it. Just accept it. The movie's there. Okay, just accept it. That's called original sin, meaning you got to watch this movie. Yeah. But as you're watching this movie and not trying to make it any better or anything, it's kind of boring too. And then spend your time, the majority of your time, observing the situation and listening within to the voice of clarity within. and listen to the explanations that are given about the big picture. Try to see the big picture, but don't spend your time monkeying with the movie. So many people have heeded this. Many cultures, religions have heeded this advice. This is the right advice, actually. But our modern culture stopped listening. It stopped listening. And what happened was the third dimensionals in this world, enough third dimensionals stopped listening to this wisdom to invite fourth dimensionals into this world who don't pay attention to that and have been on a long, dead-end type of loop. And now the fourth dimensionals are here, and they're very foolish about it. And they pay no heed to that advice whatsoever, thinking that the fourth dimension will somehow eventually become paradise. And they won't have to ever leave it. They'll be able to stay there forever, which is nonsense. So we have now in this world a mixture of third and fourth dimensionality. And we have a globe that has essentially abandoned wisdom and is now trying everything they can to improve the movie. To make it snazzier and sexier and more interesting and attractive and pleasant and comfortable, and you know, let's make death invisible, let's pump everybody up with hormones and pharmaceuticals and medical procedures, and whatever happens, we'll keep you going, and then when you drop dead, we'll quickly whisk you away to the morgue, and you'll be incinerated and no signs. Let's keep sickness off the streets. Let's keep everything looking like it's really, really wonderful. Everybody's happy here. So the movie starts losing its effectiveness, because again, the movie's not an end in itself. It's a means to avoid total mental chaos, which is necessary. And so by seeing this movie, just a basic movie, the basic no frills movie, you're seeing this gradual impermanence of everything. Someone dies and you hold a wake and you mourn the loss, and someone else dies and someone else is born, and it kind of goes like that, and it just keeps you distracted. But it also enables you to every day go in and read some holy scripture, some clarification, and then contemplate, pray for insight and guidance and freedom, liberation, deliverance from this, both the movie and what the movie's defending against simultaneously, both of those. It enables one to do that. So that's how it has to be done. That's how it has to be done. That's why we're taught, hey, accept this quote-unquote original sin. Accept the fact that you're in this dilemma, that you need to be distracted, and it's not pleasant. Accept the unpleasantness of it, and don't spend all your time trying to be clever, because you'll outsmart yourself. What we've done in the world right now is we've outsmarted ourselves. Definitely. I know for a fact that I basically deactivated a lot of my mental capacities on purpose here, so I wouldn't use them. I wouldn't use them. In eighth grade, I decided to stop paying any attention to mathematics, which I was very, very, very swift at. I had the kind of mathematical mind that could have made a ton of money. And I decided, no, this is not it. I don't want to go down that path. And I deactivated that. So I've deactivated a lot of my capabilities and talents, etc., so I would not get caught up in that. So I seem to be not very clever at all. And not able to earn a good living, and not able to thrive here at all, lacking the cleverness. But that was a choice that I made. They said, yeah, this is the way to go. We have to go this way. If you want to succeed, you have to not get caught up in your own talents. Rather, get caught up in the clarification that is within, voice of reason that's within. Get caught up in that instead of your own talents and skills. So if you feel that you're not caught up in your own talents, instead you're listening to the voice of reason, then you for sure you're on the right path. Then you've made the right decisions. And it's aggravating to see other people, you know, succeed in this world and go great guns, and you know that you have the equal capacity, for sure, if you exercise your talents. Except you realize, no, don't try to exercise all these talents of cleverness. Don't. We have the capacity to get clever, about the situation here, but we don't, should not do that. And that's what we've been warned against. That's what we've been warned against, to get too clever. You know, don't get too clever in making clothing and styles and all this stuff. You know, just, you got a linen, you know, just a beige linen shirt, wear a beige linen shirt, and maybe it'll last you 30 years or more. Don't get too clever about, you know, wear a pair of sandals. Wear a pair of sandals. Maybe the sandals will last 10 years. Or fix them when they get old. Put new soles on them. Oh, sure, you could develop, you know, thousands and thousands of running shoes, right? As we're doing now. I mean, the number of shoes, just, if you, I used to go, I'd spend days, a day, I would simply go around to all these stores, fancy stores and places, shoe store, and just look at all the shoes. Look at all the shoes. Vast emporiums of shoes, fancy department stores, all these shoes. Men's and women's shoes, bargain shoes, you know, on bargain various stores, thousands upon thousands upon thousands. And then I do it again some little later, and they're all new styles. And if I went into a store right now, all new styles. There's a constant parade of new styles of shoes, as a matter of fact. But in a wise society, everybody would probably just be wearing the Huarache sandal, you know, just a pair of sandals, same sort of sandals. When they need to, going barefoot, or when they need to wear sandals, just wearing sandals. Flip-flop, pair of flip-flops or something. That's it. That's it. You see, it's not because they're dumb, but they say, hey, we don't want to waste our time in trying to produce a constant parade of glossy, sleek, very, very clever shoe styles. Same goes for all clothing. All clothing. The styles are constantly changing. Never ending. I used to go to thrift stores and look at all the used clothing just to see the unbelievable kaleidoscopic display of the clothes that have been in the past. And it's just mind-blowing. Absolutely mind-blowing. Fashions continuously change. Patterns, everything changes in a kaleidoscope. Well, this here is just, it's just this sand beige linen shirt. That's it. A few buttons. That's it. This is the same kind of shirt that people have been wearing for thousands of years. Just a linen shirt. I mean, I don't know if they had buttons a thousand years ago, but it's just a basic linen shirt. You know, flax been used. Flax, linen, cotton, whatever. Just a simple shirt. That's it. Just natural color or just dyed earth tone or something, you know, nothing sophisticated at all. Now, we're not saying that there shouldn't be any improvements at all. There's some basic things. Glasses are very, very, very helpful. And you know, but you have to see, the ancient people had remedies for the ailments that they had. They had plant-based remedies. And they managed to get by pretty well. I mean, we have longer lifespans now. But think about this. Most people I see now live to be 90 years old. If you really ask them honestly, they never spent a day in their lives in contemplation. Not one day. Not one day. Now, let's take a person that lives 50 years. Okay. In olden times, maybe 50 years would be a good life. And let's say they spent 35 years of that time, starting at age 15, in contemplation. Now, who lived the better life? Who lived the more valuable, better life? It's not just how long we live. It's how we live, how we use our time. So we can easily waste an entire lifespan of 90 to 100 years, easily. Or we can live, let's say, 70 years, and use that time so wisely that we are able to completely set down the entire universe. The time spent on personal grooming can be absolutely minimal. Absolutely minimal. People didn't used to shave, didn't used to have haircuts, etc. Well, if we want to shave, that's fine. Going to get a haircut occasionally, that's fine. But the basic idea is minimal time on all that. Basic, keep it basic, keep it simple. Keep the styles just timeless, just basic stuff. Let everything just be basic. Bread, we've always had bread, right? Bread and cheese, you know, basic food, bread, cheese, and wine. Or apple juice, or lemonade. yogurt, we've had yogurt, berries, yogurt, oatmeal, bread, cheese. There's basic foodstuffs have been around for us throughout civilization. Just keep the basic foodstuffs, just keep it basic. Cottage cheese. You know, a loaf of French bread, some cheese, some lemonade, very good. And some people will have, you know, some chicken if they're carnivores, some chicken, some fish. We've had fish, you know, forever. Have some fish, have some rice. You could say have some seaweed. Have some rice, have rice wine, have some beer, whatever. The foodstuffs have been around for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. But keep it simple. Keep it simple. So it's quick. I eat basically the same thing every day, and it just boom, 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 that's it. Not really thinking about it. Occasionally, you have a little variation. Might have some corn chips or something, I don't know. I had a treat tonight. First time I've had any sweets in a long time. I had a lemon turnover. A little lemon turnover with butter. That's very good. But again, that's simple. You know, dough's been around. Pastries have been around. So we don't. It's not like we have to live on just gruel. But the whole idea is to keep it all simple. Keep it all basic. So that frees up our time, frees up all our time to then spend in contemplation. And the problem is nowadays that when people get free time, they spend it getting high, you know, on drugs. And listening to music and trying to make their grooving on their life. You know, like, hey, this movie's really groovy now or something. No, that's not the right use of time. Right use of time is to say, hey, I'm nervous. Everything's impermanent. This movie sucks. But I realize I need to find the root of this. Why are we watching this movie? What's the compulsion? Why do we have to watch it? What's giving rise to it? Why is it here? What's the whole big picture? Let me see the big picture. How do we get free, truly free and delivered from this movie and from whatever's generating, etc.? And then contemplating that and clarifying it. And you don't feel high. You don't feel like everything's, you know, you're not partying or anything. No, it's like just kind of basic work. Like you're driving a car. You know, you're driving here, you're making this turn, making that turn, you're driving a car. It's kind of like driving a car. You're paying attention. You're getting somewhere. Now, I like trains, the idea of train travel in the past, because you just get on the train and you don't have to drive the train. You can sit there while you're going to your destination and use that time to contemplate. You don't have to drive. You don't have to worry about traffic. It's actually a very, very good mode of transportation. So we have abandoned wisdom. We've abandoned it. And now the fourth dimensionals are here, and they're stoking the fire, saying, hey, abandoning wisdom is the new wisdom, is what they say. Really, that's the motto. Abandoning wisdom is the new wisdom. Actually, it's the old folly, same old folly. So the idea is in watching the movie and just being content with it is not because you like the movie, it's because you're determined to get free of entirely. You're not trying to make the movie glossy and a little more interesting. Forget it. See, now this movie's going to be terrible no matter what. No matter what, no matter how many dancing girls there are, this movie is still going to be terrible. So why even worry about the dancing girls, you know? Why worry about the chorus and the theater and all this entertainment and stuff? What's the purpose of it? That doesn't help at all clarify why are we watching this movie in the first place? It doesn't clarify it at all. It just diverts our attention from what we need to do. So now, I'm sure right now I could be producing songs, absolutely, working in music and having, you know, thinking, feeling very creative, but I don't do it. I don't do it. I say, no. So let that talent sit. That's not what I came here to do. I came here to get free of this movie entirely. I want to see the movie of bliss. And fiddling around with guitar and keyboards and making synthesizers and making jingles and songs, and I could compose a symphony, an opera, I could do anything. I could write an opera for sure, anything. Anything in music I could do. But I said, no, enough's enough. Wasted enough time on music. That's not it. I could have been a gambler. I could have played the stock market, or been a gambler on sports, or all this kind of stuff. I would have been very good, but my whole life would have been obsessed with that. Not spend any minute of time really in contemplating what's how to get free of this movie. So, wisdom is, don't exercise your talents here, except as a baseline. And right now, I'm not really exercising any talents at all, hardly. Just a very menial, low position in the world. Which is okay, because I'm able to spend the time on contemplation. So there's wisdom to the measures that humanity voluntarily accepts. In recognition, deep inner recognition, like, hey, this is what needs to be done in order to get free of this whole terrible nightmare of impermanence. Because this nightmare is necessary as long as we don't choose a new idea. You see, as long as we don't choose a new idea, the idea of what if reality were permanent and can't be changed, we got no choice but to watch this movie of impermanence. None whatsoever. And those people who are trying to make this movie nicer, that's backwards, because they're not paying any attention to why do we have to watch it in the first place. They're not getting to the root of it, the cause of it, and changing the cause of it at all. They're just saying, well, let's just make the effects, you know, more bubbly and frothy and more interesting. Let's put some bows on it, bows and ribbons on it. If we feel bad, let's get a makeover. Let's go shopping. You know, that's the new therapy. Well, it's the old new therapy. It's a therapy that's been going on forever. Hey, we feel the blues. Let's go out and buy stuff. Which then we need surpluses in order, you know, to do that. You need people spending their lives producing all the stuff instead of contemplating. So instead, when you feel the blues, sit down and start clarifying. Start clarifying. Calming down. Looking within. Forget about the external world. What's happening there. What looking within means is to pay more attention to the mental processes, what's going on in your attention, and selecting this and that, your defenses. Pay more attention to that than what's going on in the external world. It's more important. So right now there's a basketball game on television. It's more important to focus on this. That's all it means. You don't have to be in some special state to clarify. It's just that the preponderance of your attention is on clarification and noticing connections and connecting the dots. And the only modicum of attention is on the external world. The existential situation is not very important. Whatever's happening is not very important. It doesn't really matter that much. You'll pick up the threads a little bit later, you know, but you're just not really following it. Now, I went through this meditation a couple days ago, and A Course in Miracles suggested that you for a moment, drop all names of things and accept the name of God. Say, the name of God is my inheritance. There's just one name for everything, actually, which is God, but actually God has no name at all. So the name of God is an intermediate step, actually, which is the name of God, I would say, is blessed, this blissful overlay. And I got into that, and I accepted, like, yeah, dropping all names. I said, okay. So then I went into a store that I'm used to going into, and I know everybody there. It's like going into the Cheers bar. So everybody knows your name, right? Everybody knows me. I know everybody there, the name. And I forgot everybody's name. And it's like, I was talking with someone, and I just, like, I couldn't remember his name at all. It's like, wow. So I just avoided using his name. Hey, how you doing? Hey, it's great to see you. All right, take care. See you later. I forgot. I couldn't remember his name. So, you know, that's a funny thing, because usually that doesn't happen. But it shows you that you can place your attention in internally to the point where externals lose their grip. They don't grip you quite as tightly. Like, names didn't really matter to me anymore. Names really weren't that important, which they're really not. I was able to function perfectly well without using his name. Excuse me. Yeah, socialize perfectly well without using someone's name. You know who they are, they know who you are, you know. Why do you need to use their name? You don't really need to. But names become very important when we're trying to develop a sophisticated, when we're trying a society trying to improve the movie. We want to classify everything and name everything, so we can then chemically reduce everything and rearrange the chemicals of everything. And that's where science comes in, measurement and naming everything and measuring everything and then rearranging everything. You know, maybe in simpler situations, people, they see a plant and they just, oh, that plant is good to eat. That's the one that's good, tastes good. This one's good for your stomach. If you have a stomach problem, that plant's good for your stomach. And, oh, they know this tree gives these tasty, you know, tasty little things to eat, berries or something. The ones that are blue, the ones that are red or something. But naming can be simple. It doesn't have to be super complex. The way we've made naming unbelievably complex now. And you go in. I went in and got tomatoes, and there are now so many heirloom tomatoes that it's super hard to find something. It's just like, wait a minute. It's everywhere you go. There's a name. This tomato's name different than that one. Every tomato has got a different name. You know, it's all these heirloom tomatoes. Someone told me there's like thousands of heirloom tomatoes in the world. There's thousands of them. Well, that may be fun, and it is fun. I planted a bunch of heirloom tomatoes along with the standards. I planted the standards to make sure I got a good crop, and then I threw in, just for fun, a bunch of the, you know, exotic heirlooms. But it's not really necessary. For my whole life, I've been happily, very happy with early girls, you know, just, and cherry tomatoes. Cherry tomatoes, early girls, that's all I need. That's fine. I never even was aware of heirlooms. And recently it's become all the rage. I went in to get peppers today, and I've been looking at various peppers in different stores, and the number of peppers is unbelievable, too. There's just so many varieties. It's incredible. I don't have room to plant them all. I actually got a couple of different ones this time. And the differentiations, they got the, even in one variety, they got different colors. The red habanero, the orange habanero, the green habanero peppers, you know. And so there's just this differentiation. People are breeding, hybridizing, doing this, and there's just more of every kind of pepper. Now, a lot of people will just plant like serrano peppers, and that's good. That's fine. Because those are so tasty. Just right, just the right heat. Or little Thai peppers or something. That's just right. And but now I have what, how many, like 20 varieties of peppers, probably at least 20 different varieties of peppers. Probably 10, maybe a dozen varieties of tomatoes planted, maybe about 6 varieties of squash, that kind of thing. So every year it gets more and more different varieties. The funny thing is that in flowers, the trend is toward dwarfs, all dwarfs now. It's incredible. I talked to the order in a major nursery, the one that does the ordering. I said, "What's going on?" I said, "I noticed like zinnias. You cannot get the full pom-pom zinnias anymore. I mean, it's all dwarfs. They're like daisies or something." I said, "What about what's going on?" And they say, "Yeah, that's the trend. I mean, it's super hard to get these zinnias anymore. It's hard to get the big snapdragons. It's super hard to get the big marigolds. I used to get marigolds that would go up to 2.5, 3 feet, bushes like a hedge. They're fabulous, absolutely fabulous. You could plant those, and you would have a 2.5 foot hedge by 2.5 feet wide, with thousands of marigolds on it. It's just like unbelievable, beautiful, beautiful. You can't get it anymore. It's super hard to get that anymore." They said, "Hey, we can't, literally, our supplier doesn't even have them. It's all dwarfs, 12 inches high. And the zinnias are that way. You can get State Farm zinnias, which a country fair zinnias, which grow like 6 feet high. But even they're sold out instantly, and you can't get any more. I got some this year." So the trends are towards modification of everything. The old good standbys that I'd be happy with, No, now you every year they tweak it, they tweak it, they tweak it in all sorts of different ways. It's that way with everything. It's like cars. I was talking to a mechanic, an owner of a mechanic shop today, and he said, my truck suddenly stopped working. Engine light went on, lost all power. And I took it into him, and he tested. He said, "Wow, you got some really strange computer codes there. There's no, we can't even fix it. It's so messed up." And so I was told that sometimes if you just wait, the computer will reset itself. So I waited, and later in the day, I went back. The engine light was off, and everything was fine. And then today he asked me, "What happened? Did you get it fixed?" I said, "No, it just fixed itself." And he goes, "Whoa, that's amazing." He says, "I tell you, it really, you just don't, it's out of your control. You don't have no control over what's taking place with the cars these days." And he said it could happen again, and you don't know what's going to happen. And I said, "Yeah, I know. It's like there's so much electronics and computerization of the cars. You can't fix stuff anymore." And he said, "You know what? I used to, all I needed was a screwdriver. I used to be able to fix just about anything on the car, just a screwdriver, okay?" And he still has the old cars from this in the 50s, 60s, whatever, that you can still fix them with just a screwdriver. Just adjust, you can adjust whatever you need to adjust. It's true. Nowadays, you're lost. Even he couldn't even fix the car with his computerized system and everything. He said the codes were too difficult. Too difficult to fix the car, too sophisticated. Do we really need that sophistication is the question. Now they're trying to have self-driving cars. Do we really need that? How wise is that actually? How wise are the tech titans actually when it comes to wisdom? When it comes to spiritual wisdom, how do they rank? You see, compare Jesus to Google, for instance. Who's wiser? In right use of time and how, and right structuring of society for right use of time, right use of mind. Who's wiser, you see? How do they compare, that kind of thing? Do we really need self-driving cars? Really, I think we're all capable of driving cars. And if life weren't so sophisticated and frantic, we'd be all much better drivers. There'd be less cars on the road. We wouldn't be in such a hurry. we'd all be more patient and more considerate. And you know what? I bet you everyone would be driving a heck of a lot better if we weren't so frantic right now. So I guess they're feeling that the future is going to be so unbelievably frantic they need self-driving cars just to deal with the mishmash and craziness of it all. And yeah, so but the trends are overwhelming here on this planet. It's unmistakable. There's no way of going back. You're not going to turn the whole planet into an Amish community. It's not going to happen. The world economy would have to completely collapse first. I mean, everything, but the collapse of the world economy would plunge the world into a nightmare. You know, we're dependent on GMO seeds now, basically. You know, having to buy from one supplier, all the seeds from one supplier. They're trying to monopolize all seeds or food from one supplier. How wise is that? How wise is that? And how wise is it to have all these seeds genetically modified? You know, is that how wise is that? What if they get some disease in those seeds that somehow attach themselves to that? You know, we've lost the natural heirloom varieties of corn and soy and wheat and all this kind of stuff. You know, it's vanishing. Our food supply is in a perilous condition, actually. More and more sophistication. Trying to produce the perfect food, perfect fruit, perfect crop. Trying to say, hey, let's feed, instead of feeding a billion people in the world, let's feed 7 billion. You know, and let's have them all have a full stomach and make sure everything works perfectly smoothly, etc. So how wise is that actually? It's not wise. Have simple clothes, simple bed, simple grooming, simple life, simple pleasures, and use your time to discover the actual situation and how to be truly free and delivered from all fear. And then you will experience deliverance from it. And then you'll look back and say, wow, that was time very well spent. So the pressure is on in right now in today's world to not use your time wisely. Too much pressure in that regard. Yeah, you have to go underground to do it, to use your time wisely. You have to, it's like going out and sneaking a smoke these days, you know. You see the people say, oh, I gotta go to the bathroom, I gotta, excuse me. And then, what, they go outside, I have a friend who has to go outside and sneak a smoke, and then he comes back in, you know. And that has to do that. It's very, very smooth at doing it. So we have to go out and sneak some time to clarify the situation here. And this clarification wouldn't seem so odd if the people in the world were all doing this. It used to be that the understandings were more clear than today. Today we think they're clear because we think we're smarter. But what we're really doing is we're saying, okay, this teaching has to fit in and connect up with and unite with the sophistication we're doing. So we reinterpret it in terms of being compatible with our lifestyle and sophistication we have. And in doing so, we completely misinterpret the teaching. It's like we want to have our cake and eat it too, and we misinterpret it. Because the teaching says, you know, the first shall be last, and the last shall be first. The meek shall inherit the earth, the blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall be saved. In other words, blessed the ones who take this meek, humble, simple lifestyle are the ones that will be saved. The ones that spend their life trying to be vainglorious and all sophisticated and show off all their talents to the world, and they're trying to be first, will be last. They'll be the last to get it. And the ones who are willing to put their all their cleverness on hold, live a simple life, bread and cheese and wine, and keep things simple, they'll do the necessary work and they will be delivered and free, and they'll be the first, you know, they'll be first to get deliverance, experience bliss. That's the truth. That's what Jesus is pointing out. He's pointing out to a very important dynamic of the situation here. And people used to get that. They don't get it anymore. It's not that the people in the past were stupid. It's just they realize, hey, it's stupid to use our cleverness. Using our cleverness is stupid. So they're smarter than we were, actually. There's a fact. The people in the past actually were smarter than we are because they understood their priorities better. And they said, you know what? I could be really clever and do a lot of real clever calculations. I know I can do it because I did it in fourth dimensional, but no, that's stupid. I know it's wrong. I'm not going to do it. I'm going to live a simple, humble life. Maybe I'll be a miller and I'll grind grain so people, you know, we can make bread and people can eat. Or maybe I'll grow a field of wheat and some vegetables and help people eat. Or maybe I'll be a tailor and make simple clothes, or what they call a shoe milliner or something. Someone who makes shoes. I'm not sure what they call that. The idea is there. And, you know, simple stuff. Maybe I'll be a carpenter and just build, you know, simple home, help people have a simple dwelling place. Maybe I'll be an herbalist or someone who helps people with you know, simple cures for or remedies for, you know, ailments, something like that, or be a midwife or help out with births. Simple society. Maybe I will hold satsang, be someone who holds satsang for the community. So simple roles, simple life, and yet super effective life. And so who's being smarter? It's those who do that who are actually being really smart, because they're saying, wait a minute, I'm not going to use all the cleverness, ingeniousness. I used to be able to look at stuff and see invention, see all the ways I could improve the world. Nonstop. It's unbelievable. I said, my gosh, I can literally churn out seamless stream of inventions to improve the quality, the qualitative nature of life here, supposedly, you know, make things smoother, better, whatever. Just boom, 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 boom. But I said, no. That's a waste of time. Same thing with songs. I could compose songs nonstop. If I get into that mode, really, really, really nice songs if I want to. But no, say forget it. That's a waste of my time. And everybody's the same way. We all have these capabilities, these clever capabilities. And occasionally it keeps cropping up. I'll say, hey, you know, here's a really good invention. And in fact, it really is a terrific invention. Something that people, that no one's done before. It's just obvious. But you'll spend a lifetime trying to push that through, and then someone in some other country doesn't respect copyright, will, you know, steal your invention, mass produce it, undercut you, and, you know, you probably will end up broke and bankrupt. So it's, you know, it's that way. So we're all very clever, but it's those who don't use that cleverness who are the most clever. We're all very smart. But it's those who don't use that smartness who are really super smart. In other words, they don't use that. We're all super clever. It's those who don't use that cleverness are the most clever. It's like that. So I know the teachers always told me, you're so smart, but you're not using it. And they're very frustrated about that. I get reports saying that he's such a gifted student, he's so smart, but for some reason he doesn't quite apply it, doesn't use it. That was by design. I said, no. I see something that's way smarter than that. You know, don't use it. You use your time and smartness to uncover the root of existence and the God's plan of salvation. Use your efforts to do that. Now, a lot of times it's people who don't go to college or drop out of college who end up being the most successful, because for them, they know how to do what they want to do, and they say, I don't need to waste my time, you know, in college. I'm going to go do it right now because I know I can do it, and they just go do it. But they're still using their cleverness. In my case, I said, forget, so education is a complete waste of time, because all it's trying to do is get me to use all my cleverness and ingenuity and waste my life. And not interested in that. So I was smart enough to see through all of that. And that's what it takes in this world. Otherwise, we'll feel insecure. I say, wow, I better get the diploma and all this stuff because, you know, I don't want to seem to be dumb. And, but for me, I'd already been smart. Like in a previous lifetime, I was so successful with great cleverness that I said, what do I need to do that again? I already know what that's like. I know what that life is like. And people want to think I'm stupid. Why should I pay any attention to what they say? You know, I know that's not true. So I kind of had this complex of confidence where it really didn't matter if people, you know, they thought I was dumb. I'd just water off my duck's back kind of thing. Eventually it gets a little irritating, you know. It wears on you. It wears on you. Not having a college degree, you know, in this society, that's like, you know, it's your identity. It's your identity papers. You don't have a college degree. People who do don't even want to associate with you. But I realized I was way smarter than the professors and the teachers, etc. And I said, why should I spend all my time, you know, kowtowing to them and giving them the answers that they want? It's a waste of my time. It's ridiculous. I'm not going to learn anything there. I'm going to be dumbed down, as a matter of fact. So I said, you know, forget it. Circumstances arranged themselves, so I didn't pay any attention to academics, which is a very good thing. I could have written innumerable books, academic books, if I went that route, academic route, just churned them out. And I could say, you know, hey, I've published 50 books and 150 articles and all this, and, you know, inventions and blah, 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 whatever, you know. So what? I'd probably be completely ignorant about, you know, salvation, deliverance, freedom. Completely ignorant. Wasted life. Except next life, I'd say, hey, nah, forget that. I'm not going to do that again. Not going to waste my time like that again. So the so-called higher education would not be an emphasis in a sane society at all. What do you mean higher education? How about true education? Education about truth. That's the only education we need. We don't need this higher education at all. We don't need all the sophistication that higher education brings. It brings with it more problems than it solves. You know, yes, sometimes starvation happened in ancient times. But usually it happened when society got taken over by sophisticated, clever people who were into making profits through surplus. Okay, that's what happened. Otherwise, normal, simple people generally don't starve. I asked some friends from Mexico about this very issue. I asked them a very interesting question. I said, where you come from, which is out in rural Mexico, do any people down there in Mexico that you know, any of the people in your town, for instance, do they ever worry about starvation? Do they ever worry about that? And he said, no, nobody, never even crosses our mind. I was like, huh? I said, but it's such a simple society. And I said, do they ever worry about homelessness? He said, never crosses our minds, impossible. And he's blown away. They're blown away by people here, homeless people. They say, what the heck's going on here? People begging from food. They're starving, you know. They're not. He says, it's impossible. He said, no, nobody can starve down there. It's not possible, he said. And I said, has there ever been, you know, something in your consciousness, you're worried about starvation? He says, no, it's not something we ever even talk about or think about. It's not possible. Living off the land, he says, what he said was only an idiot, a lazy idiot, could possibly starve to death there, in that area. He says, not, it's just, if you have to, you can live off the land, absolutely. But, you know, there's plenty of fish, there's plenty of fruit, you can plant crops, you can raise chickens. I mean, everybody has this self-sufficiency, and anybody who has troubles, other people help them out, and there's no even thought of starvation. Whereas here in this society, my God, starvation is something I think about constantly, because if you don't have money to function here, you can easily starve. Now, we try desperately to have safety, but it's a very thin situation here. You can easily be homeless here, very easily be homeless. And there, now, you've got everybody has so many relatives and interconnected, and the families are also interconnected. It is completely unthinkable, he said, that anybody could be homeless, completely unthinkable. And this is a simple, basic, rural society. No fear of starvation, no fear of homelessness. Imagine. I can't even imagine such a thing. I've spent my whole life being afraid of homelessness. I don't have the money to afford a home. If I had to be paying for everything my own, be homeless. But so the fact that our belief that somehow simpler, more basic communities would somehow lead to our starvation, homelessness, is completely opposite. It's just the opposite. It's this super sophisticated society that is threatening us with homelessness and starvation. Absolutely. I mean, if you couldn't go down, you didn't have the money to go buy food, what the heck would you do here? You know, there, everybody's got chickens, everybody's got cows, everybody's got pigs, everybody can go catch wildlife, deer, and various wildlife. They can go fish, they all know how to fish, they can get a ton of fish, they all have seeds, they know all, these rural people have seed banks in the villages, they all have seeds, they're experts at planting seeds, they can grow anything from seeds. They know how to keep the seeds, they know how to cure the seeds. And they can grow stuff. They've got cheese from the cows. They know how to make cheese. And so they know how to make food. They're not in the slightest bit worried about starving to death. How could they? They've survived floods and fires. All this stuff. No, nobody starves to death there. Now, the situation could arise where a severe drought or something like that. But even then, they find ways. They find ways. They're very, very adaptive. They know if they have to go down the food chain, they can go down the food chain. And even in a drought, ultimately, they could go to the ocean and get fish. You know, they're just very resourceful. Never depending on anyone else as far as a government or anything like that, but just very resourceful, producing their own food, their own clothes, and very carefree type of society. I've met these people, and they're very, very calm. This peace of mind and calm and clarity and intelligence, very intelligent, very observant. And they're not simpletons at all, not simpletons at all. Deep, very great faith. You can see there's a depth to their characters. But you know, they don't have the sophistication of the modern world. But oh my gosh, I see so many people here just destitute. You go into cities, you know, the destitution is unbelievable. And so many people slipping through the cracks, just right and left, right and left, right and left. While we're you know, going out shopping for, you know, $300 pair of pants or something, or shoes or whatever, just, you know, designer stuff, you know, and so it's a bizarre situation that we think somehow this sophisticated structure we have has made us all safer. It hasn't. But all we need is a roof over our head and something to eat, really. And then simple enjoyment of life and just taking it in and then realizing our opportunity to transcend all that. Let's get free of all of it. That's great. It's great. That's fabulous. You know, simple people, they go swim in a river, swim in a lake, go sail on the ocean, suntan on the beach. Simple pleasures. Maybe they have a cerveza in the evening, relax, sit around and just enjoy each other's company. Talk about simple things. You know, it can be, it's not like a boring lifestyle actually at all. And they don't have this inner dread of if I don't, you know, I might lose my job tomorrow and I'm going to be homeless then. I mean, how many people here is, you know, they could be laid off tomorrow from their job. And the people are getting laid off right and left. It's unbelievable. And what are they going to do? They go on unemployment, but a lot of them have payments that there's no way they can possibly survive on unemployment. And they'd have to come just drastically downsize everything. Go from an affluent, you know, situation to cramped apartment. It's brutal. The fear in society right now is just brutal. Why people are on edge. So the demonization of the past, of simpler societies, is all backwards and upside down and backwards. When you have a simple life, your mind can put a tremendous amount of tension on clarification. You can bring the fullness of your mind into consideration. And you're not worried about how you might temporarily feel a little bit out of sorts, because you're not some kingpin, you're not the linchpin of some vastly sophisticated technical process that everything has to work perfectly, etc., etc. No, you can still handle a simple lifestyle, even though you might have seen an insight that makes you go, huh, wow, I'm gonna my whole worldview has changed, changing. You don't feel threatened by it so much. It used to be that there were a lot of saints and sages, etc., in the world. That really was. There really were. Really. Nowadays, forget it. They're like desperate to elevate various people, like for instance the Catholic Church, they're trying to elevate into the steps to being declared a saint. You know, bureaucrats, yeah, or something. I mean, it's just incredible. You used to have real saints who were delivered from impermanence, who made exchange of hypotheticals, who dwelled in the presence of bliss, were in the presence of bliss, who were in the presence of the divine light, who communed with God. You used to have saints that were like that. Amazing, just stupendously wonderful. Who got the job done? They got the job done way more. And now, it's like, wow. Now we're just taking these ontological positions, basically, of all various types of this and that, depending. But who's dwelling in bliss? That's real deliverance. Who's actually dwelling in bliss? And not just some mental state. So, it's a result of wrong priority, wrong emphasis that has taken place. And the denouement of all that is coming up, the climax, the utter fin de siècle, the end of the world, collapse of civilization, all this stuff is coming up as a backlash to all the sophistication, which causes an uprising, a seeping in of the sphere of mental chaos, which then requires a vast sacrificial kind of thing, something that emphasizes, you know, loss, limited loss, to a very intense vividness of it, instead of just sort of a mellow gradualness, like which the movie ideally is supposed to be, a mellow gradualness of loss. We'll have a very chaotic, severe, terrible, intense type of loss situation, which, you know, doubles down on the defensiveness, because it's a reaction to feeling this mental chaos. The reaction is like to go ah, like that. Whereas if you have this mellow, stable condition, you're not going, you're not reacting, overreacting. What's going to happen is an overreaction, and people just, like, you know, tear out their hair and say, oh my God, let's just bring everything, you know, let's just tear everything to pieces. That's the trouble. Now, the hippies in the 60s, they realized this. They said, hey, we got to get back to the land. Let's get back to a simpler lifestyle here. See, they're wise. They said, let's stop being all sophisticated, you know. If we want sophistication, I'll make a tie-dyed shirt, you know. Let's get back just to handcrafts and living off the land and going to meditation and satsang. So there was that big movement for a while that people realize what the future was going to be, and they just said, whoa, no way, this is terrible, no way. But now, unfortunately, the hippies, a lot of them, you know, have to survive, a lot of them have become quite sophisticated business people. They may be running organic farms, etc., communes, but they got all their computers and spreadsheets, and they're expert business people. And they're very much sophisticated in that. So eventually it tends to creep up on you. It's difficult to maintain that simplicity of lifestyle in today's world. It's Well, we don't need to go there. We don't need to keep giving examples. That's enough. This is enough examples. It's obvious what we're talking about. So there's a lot of politics involved. Those who believe in sophistication kind of want to criminalize non-sophistication. And, you know, the hunter-gatherer lifestyle, the simple live off the land, they say, that's passé. We don't do that anymore. Kind of thing. We all depend on GMO seeds. And that's it. And we got ailments. We all depend on the pharmaceuticals. That's it. And et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And now everybody has to have health insurance. What if you live off the land? You want to go to the shaman or the medicine man or medicine woman or whatever. And or you want to go to a sweat lodge, or you want to have a communal prayer session where you help align that person back to a stable baseline kind of thing. There are many ways to heal other than pharmaceuticals, and in fact many ways that are way better, but that's basically being criminalized more and more and more criminalized. And if one person has a trouble, they'd want to outlaw it all, you know. They want to control, you know, dairy products, milk, everything, our food supply. They want to control. They want to make sure it only comes through sophistication, not through simplicity. Yes, and healing especially, you know, that's, a good medicine man or woman can really, really heal whatever, just by helping them get back to just a basic baseline of the movie. And absolutely. Same with judicial system. The sophistication of the legal system has just gone absolutely bonkers. Communities are able to police themselves, are able to take care of the problems within the community, simple communities, are able to do that very well. People keep themselves, each other in check. When there's problems, they're work it out within the context of their faith. And it is a way better system, actually. The legal system we have now in the world is so utterly bizarre. It is just beyond belief, really. It's gotten so sophisticated and complex that now we have, you know, bills that are like 10,000 pages or something. And every bill that passed, it seems like there's just, you know, 1,000 pages in it. Of non-ending complexity. And the people who pass the laws don't even know what's in them. Which just gives rise for the need for ever more lawyers. And ever more profits for lawyers. Where you know, in simple, effective community, there's no need for lawyers. Which is why maybe the lawyers are trying to write laws to make it illegal to go back to such simple living, right? I mean, who's in charge of the planet? Lawyers are in charge, actually. Politicians, most of them are lawyers. And lawyers like getting rich. And they like it. They like what sophistication riches can buy. And they want to pass laws which make it necessary for them to be perpetually employed with more and more and more benefits and riches for themselves. Shakespeare said, if you want to get rid of what is ailing society, first you have to get rid of all the lawyers. And Shakespeare is very wise indeed. But the lawyers say, well, it's illegal to get rid of the lawyers. So you have that, you see. And the lawyers are passing ever more laws to demonize simplicity, simple society, where lawyers aren't really needed very much at all. People can work things out. When there's a basic faith, a basic understanding, a basic simplicity and all of that, there are certainly ways within a community to work things out. Not always perfectly, of course. And there are some simple, you know, steps that can be taken. Like simple societies, simple villages, there might be a guru or something of that area. And if there's some trouble, then the guru is asked to intervene, and the guru knows how to solve the situation, how to restore harmony in the situation. So, but we tend to look down our noses at simpler social structures. Like how could people be such primitives? Don't they know the sophistication we have now? Are you kidding? we have a nightmare. We have a Frankenstein monster on our hands. And the Frankenstein monster, we got Godzilla after us. And we ask, what have we done? What have we done? You know, how can we set it right? Well, at this point, it's a little too late in the game. What's going to happen is, again, the persecution complex is going to arise. And that's going to lead to big troubles. Once you get sophisticated, it's very difficult to drop it. That's what I found out. I've gone through that. I put myself through it, and to see what kind of addiction it was like is difficult. It's very difficult, very difficult. You have to be incredibly inspired to drop it. Once you get ease and comfort of living and sophistication and all this kind of stuff, you would just rather die than to drop it. You don't want to drop it at all. So it's not like people are just going to drop it. No way. They're going to do fight tooth and nail to keep it. Do everything possible, whatever it takes. They're going to try and have this sophisticated, complex culture triumph. Because the thought of going back to a simple, humble lifestyle is abhorrent to them, absolutely abhorrent. And I understand that. It's a very dangerous thing, getting into sophistication, actually, because it's a severe addiction. You get used to looking so magnificent, you know. So it's tough to go back in simple clothes again, kind of thing, if you're really used to, you know, beautiful everything. I mean, just how many people want to give up their refrigerators? Probably nobody. See, no way. Who want to give up their microwaves? And not many. Once you get like heating and air conditioning, who wants to give that up? Once you have that, once you get these luxuries and, you know, flush toilets, plumbing, indoor plumbing, who wants to give that up? I know someone grew up without any indoor plumbing at all, in a shack, no foundation for the shack, a shack in a dirt orchard, and they had a wonderful life, worked hard, super hard, and now they live in a palace basically, and they told me, they said, hey, I don't need to live in this palace, I'd be happy to live in the garage, you know. It's not necessary for me at all. And yet we think that it's making them happy. But, you know, not really. I mean, it's okay, but it's not really necessary. So if you really grow up and live in a simple way, then the sophistication does not get you so bad. But if you get hooked on sophistication at an early age, then it's really difficult. A notable exception to this is St. Francis, who actually grew up in a very sophisticated situation and was very badly hooked on it. He was a bon vivant. He was a rich young man and loved to dress in magnificent raiment and, you know, show off and all that kind of stuff. Party animal. He was always partying down St. Francis. And then he apparently thought better of it all. And he said, gave it all away. He said, here, threw it all out in the street. Everybody take all my clothes, forget it. And then went, you know, to live off the land in a simple hut and wearing a simple cassock garment and basically renounced sophistication. And in doing so, lived a life of contemplation and then was able to step into bliss. Was able to set the world down, the universe down. And then became an example, became a saint, rightfully so. As an example, but he's one of the, you know, one of the few who did that. That's difficult to do. Once you get hooked on the good life, it is really difficult to put it down. Seriously. Once you start pampering the senses, that is a bad road to go down. Anandamayi Ma said, don't make your life too comfortable. Okay, at all costs, guard against trying to make your life too comfortable. Don't get comfortable with your life, she said. Do not. Because just once you go down that road, it's like poison. You think it's wonderful for you, but it's really, you're like poisoning yourself. It says when you spend time indulging the senses, it feels momentarily pleasurable, but the end result is poisonous for you. So she said, don't get comfortable with your life like that. Maintain a simple, basic lifestyle. And at the forefront of that is your clarification and satsang contemplation, your prayers, your affirmations. At the forefront, absolutely. keep things clean, practice good hygiene, keep your surroundings clean and neat. Sure, absolutely, but keep it simple too. Keep it very simple. But in today's day and age, this is a pipe dream, basically. So, at this time, the goal should be reached. Forget about lifestyle at this time. It's too late for that. Keep your own moderation in your life, but it's time to succeed, which means it's time to step into bliss. Because the future's not going to support effective lifestyles. So don't count on the future here to think you have all this time and everything's fine. No. It's time to step into bliss. It's time for the path to be over with, to finish up with it, to set down the universe, set down all the potentiality of the universe, all potentials for you the universe could ever hold, set them all down, set it all down, because all it is defensiveness. That's all it will ever be. It's just simple defensiveness. And what is that? It's nothing. It's a waste of time. It's just time aimlessly spent. So set it all down. Whether you're setting, when you set down the prince, you're setting down the pauper also. Neither one serve you well. There's nothing in existence that serves us well. It's all defensiveness. It's never what we want, really want. Never. No matter how we shuffle the cards, it's never the hand that we want. A deck of cards is never going to give you five aces. It's only going to give you four. Never five. Defensiveness is never going to give us the security, the freedom, the deliverance that we really want. It's not going to give us reality at all. It's defending against a sense of total threat. How fun can that really be? Is that what we were created for? To spend all eternity defending against annihilation? The threat of annihilation? Not at all, because there's no annihilation in reality whatsoever. So it's we don't like it. And we should get free of it, be delivered from it. And we need to do that now. It'd be a very good idea to do it now. So I'm trying to step into bliss. It's not something you necessarily just force, but you can go quickly towards it. So now that we've spent this time appropriately, I can go in and see what the scores of the games were. See, that's okay. It's okay. I didn't spend time watching them, wasting time. I can find out the score in a couple seconds. And then, okay. So instead of spending an hour or two watching, I get in a couple seconds and I spend an hour or two on this consideration here. So to recap, a couple steps we take. One is to thank the mind for presenting this movie of impermanence. Is it thank you so much, mind. I love what you've done. You're my very best friend. And reconcile the inner reconciliation with the mind. Spirit and mind feeling the sense of reconciliation by spirit acknowledging that it's the one that caused mind to have to do this movie of impermanence by choosing the idea of wanting to be prime creator. So spirit says, mind, I'm so sorry that I chose this idea. It was a wrong choice, bad choice on my part. And you've done a flawless job. And mind will say, thank you, spirit, so much for recognizing that and for being willing to see. This is very difficult for you to see this, I know. And I'm happy that you've seen it. And I know you're ready to choose a new idea. And so everything is great. No problems. So that's step one. Step two then is to relinquish all future potentiality in the whole universe. Set the whole universe down as far as you're concerned. You have no claim on anything that ever happens ever in the universe. And to B is to allow dispersal of whatever karma had coming to you as experiences, events, defenses in existence. to be dispersed without you having any say where it goes. Just, it doesn't matter. True renunciation. True detachment. And then by willing to do this, and also renouncing enlightenment or any spiritual state within the universe at all. No spiritual state within the universe. You won't be a guru, within a master, or whatever, within the universe at all. You see. But Jesus said, in the world, but not of it. In other words, the bliss is not of the universe. The true master is not of this universe. So renounce all position, including spiritual positions in the universe for yourself. Do not lay claim. See, I make no claim to any of those ever. Take your name out of consideration for all of it. And then that should result in stepping into bliss. And we'll see how it goes. All right. Let's bring an end to this one. Another good one. Enjoyed this. And I feel the momentum is still... The river is flowing nicely. We can't push the river, but it's flowing very nicely right now. All right. That's it.